The Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, "For though you might have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you do not have many fathers." Alan Vincent is one of those rare fathers. He is an anointed apostle of God who provides apostolic fathering to many leaders, younger apostolic men, churches, and organizations worldwide. God has blessed him with prophetic revelation of the scriptures through which many are brought to a deeper maturity in kingdom living and service. Everything he teaches is shot through with faith. He leaves his hearers challenged to think, be, and act bigger, appropriating all that God has for them. Through his powerfully anointed teaching and relationship-based ministry, cities and regions around the world have been influenced. Alan has historic relationships in such places as India, Poland, Kenya, Nairobi, Austria, Pittsburgh, England, Botswana, Zambia, Florida, and many others. As was said of the Apostle Paul, the same may be said of Alan Vincent. My way of life in Christ Jesus agrees with what I teach everywhere in every church.
Well, let's turn now to Ephesians and chapter 2, and I think you will immediately see why we needed to establish the law of heredity. And once we've really got hold of that, and then when you start reading Ephesians chapter 2, then all the bombs start going off in your spirit. I'll just begin to read from verse 1. "And you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience." So if you let the world push you into its mold, then it's really the devil that's manipulating your life. Amen? Because he has still that exercise of authority in that system which lives in defiance to God and his kingdom. That's how I would identify the world. It's that system that defies the rule and government of God. And although we're to love it redemptively, we're not to love it in the sense of what its rewards, attributes are. In fact, we will not have anything to do with it, because that means we're loving the devil. Amen? If you love the world, you love the devil. That's right. Amen? Then it goes on to say, "Among whom," verse 3, "whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we were by nature children of wrath, just like the others. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, not because there's anything nice about us, or that we in any way have earned it, he just made a decision." Amen? He said, "I'm going to love you. I'm going to love you to death," literally. "So that you just won't want to live anymore, and you'll want the full revelation of the risen Christ in you." So he loved us to death in Christ. Amen? "Even when we," verse 5, "even when we were dead in trespasses and sins, he made us alive together with Christ." Here's these phrases start coming now. "He made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And he raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus." That takes us back to Ephesians 1:20, when we read there that Christ was gloriously raised from the dead and was immediately seated at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above. We read these glorious words yesterday. So what we're now being told, and this is the great truth that we've got to get hold of, because the pattern in Ephesians is the same as the pattern in Hebrews, which is, when the letter to the Hebrews was written, the church was under severe persecution, and they were in danger of turning back. And the writer to the Hebrews wrote that letter to steady them in a time of great persecution under Emperor Nero. And the methodology was, in chapter 1, to give us a glorious revelation of who Christ is, and then in chapter 2, to to give us a glorious revelation of who we are in him, but you can't see who you are in him until you've seen who he is. Amen? You don't see the full glory, if you like, of what God's made you until you've seen the full glory of what God has made him. And I still remember to this day in Bombay, must have been 1965, just after I had been baptized in the Spirit, Paul's prayer in Ephesians 1 happened to me, and I didn't get a vision, but I had a revelation in my spirit, and I saw the glory, the power, the majesty of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it became offensive to me that these demons dare defy him in his kingdom. And I think that's when I got angry for the first time. And when I was indignant on behalf of Christ, if you like, that he was being prevented from coming into his inheritance. And so I was going to work with him to make it happen. Amen? But then the next step is then to see what we have been made in him. Because you can be mad and powerless. Amen? If you're under some totalitarian government, you can be seething with resentment, but you've got no ability to change the system. But when you're mad and powerful, then that's a different ball game altogether. You can do something about it. Amen? And this is why we've got to see in Ephesians 2, and again in Hebrews 2, it gives us all the things that Jesus has brought us into. Well, we have the same pattern here. Okay, so the first thing that we are told is that having raised us together with Christ, he has raised us up together. The purpose is that we should sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And this is the same word, this Greek word, kathizo. We are to kathizo together with him. And let me remind you of my definition of kathizo. It's to sit down comfortably, as if you feel you belong there. You've got to have this sense of, yeah, this is where I rightfully am. If you sit there nervously saying, I'm not supposed to be here, then you haven't come to this revelation. But you sit comfortably on the throne with Christ, and this is all risen stuff. This is, if you can grasp it, this is greater than whatever he was in the world during his 33 and a half years of ministry. So in our resurrection, we've in him, and I know this will cause some people to blow a fuse, but it's still biblical, that we are greater in him, in his resurrection, than he was in the limitations of his flesh for those 33 and a half years, or particularly those 3.5 years of ministry. That's why he said, you know, when you get this, the works that I do, you're going to do also, and even greater works than these you're going to do. Of course, it's not us at all. We're just, as we said yesterday, we're just the vehicle for the almighty power of God. Amen?
Amen.
But we're not like him on earth. We're like him in heaven. We're not with him on earth. We're with him in heaven. It's a rule of a throne of incredible power and authority. And we're seated with him, comfortably, sure of what we've been called to be. And we're here to exercise rule, government, and authority. So that's why, as I said, I introduced the letter to the Ephesians. You know, you've got to learn to sit. According to the Apostle Paul, that's what you've got to learn first. When you've learned to sit, then afterwards you get into the right kind of powerful activities. Amen? But you've got to be absolutely sure of that position. So we've been made to sit with him, kathizo with him. And it goes on to say that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us. Verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. So the purposes of my salvation is that I should be delivered from the bondage of sin and of my Adamic nature, over which Satan always has power and control. But in the new risen Christ, he has no access whatsoever. He's never, ever, ever been able to touch the risen Jesus, and he never will. And in him, we are as impregnable to the devil as the risen Christ. Now the secret is to stay in him, which is a process which we have to learn. And this is, and if you can get this. Maybe your church can get this, but I've got a set of 21 tapes there on the whole book of Romans with a manual that goes with it. And in Romans 5, well, 6, 7, and 8, I mean, I go into this sort of thing in great detail. And I think I spent, I don't know how many months in my church thing and teaching this series. And it was, it is, and it's used by quite a few Bible schools around the world now as their definitive set of tapes and teaching on the book of Romans. But in this, I explain these things, you know, and I think, you know, in a way that does help to make it clear. Amen? That I'm risen with him, I'm seated with him, and I'm called to reign with him. And then you come to Romans chapter 8, and at the end of Romans 7, into Romans chapter 8, it starts talking about laws in the scientific sense. The Bible talks about law in three ways. Number one, it talks about law as a principle. You can say, I believe in law and order, or I believe in anarchy. Amen? So it uses law in that sense of it being a way by which we live in an orderly way. Then it uses law in the sense of that package of rules which were put together by Moses and then added to extensively by the scribes and the Pharisees. So they put a burden on people that almost killed them. So you have that which is called the law. That's the package of rules and regulations which the Jews decreed were necessary to make you right with God. And then you get the law used in the third way, which is like a scientific principle. We've just really been talking this morning about the law of heredity in that scientific sense. And it's like the law of gravity. It works for anyone, anywhere, anytime. You can jump off any building anywhere in the world and you will accelerate to the ground at a predictable speed because the law of gravity is always working. It doesn't matter whether you're American or Chinese, it doesn't make any difference. The law works the same, whatever your nationality, whatever your ethnicity. You can be clever or stupid, you can be fat or thin, you can be old or young, male or female. You can even leap off a building saying, I don't believe in gravity. It won't make any difference. It still works. Amen? There are relentless laws in the Spirit which work, and Luke chapter 6 gives a whole series of these. But I've talked to you about the law of heredity. It works for anyone. If you believe and you see how that we're saved by grace through faith, and it's talking to us about the throne. In other words, the whole purpose of being saved is to bring you into the throne life. The purpose of being saved is not simply that you should escape an eternity in hell. God wants to bring you into a total relationship with him and to a total place of rule and authority with him. But you've got to learn how to walk in the Spirit. And it tells us in Romans chapter 8 that there is a law called the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, which sets me free from the law of sin and death. And both these two laws are spiritual laws in that scientific sense. They always work for anybody, anywhere. So, and we're told in that passage in Romans 7 that if we try and live in the flesh, even if our flesh has become religious and we're now trying to live a holy life rather than trying to sin, if it's the flesh still, then we still find ourselves being pulled down by sin into defeat. And from Romans chapter 7, verses 15 through 24, Paul uses the pronoun I more than 30 times. He's got eye trouble. The wood that I would do, I don't do, and the evil that I don't want to do, that I do, and I find within me a principle working, which is the law of sin and death. So when I try to change my life, I find that, and of course what I'm trying to do is to try and change myself by the power of independent self, and it was independent self that got me into sin in the first place. So that's a totally futile exercise. You can't save yourself by yourself, because it was being yourself rather than being submitted to God that brought you into the bondage of sin in the first place. Yeah. So the only thing you can do is to stop trying yourself and let a new power take hold of you. Now, in the history of aerodynamics, it's quite interesting to read a bit about aerodynamics, and it's interesting how it was the French particularly who seemed determined to conquer gravity, and they made all sorts of weird flying machines. You've probably seen some of these in encyclopedias, and they would design these fantastic flying machines with lots of feathers, and these guys were so confident it would work that they would stand. One guy even stood on the Eiffel Tower and jumped off, and flapping like fury, he crashed to the ground, and the law of gravity killed him, because you see, what the weakness was, that when people tried to do it in their own strength, they couldn't overcome the law of gravity. And then one day, they discovered what's called the first law of aerodynamics. I'll give you a demonstration of this. You see, in the first law of aerodynamics, you let a flow of air pass over a curved surface. You watch. And this curved surface will lift against gravity just because of the passing of the air. I'm not blowing it underneath, I'm blowing on top, okay? As I blow on top, it creates a partial vacuum underneath, which is called lift, which is how these great jet airliners fly today, because they've learned how to exploit the power of the wind. Hello, can you hear me?
Come on.
And it's lifting because of the air flowing over it. And so when man discovered the first law of aerodynamics, he stopped trying to do it by his own effort, and he started to learn to exploit the wind. And he learned he could fly. And these days, without a thought, we get into these incredible jet airliners, maybe a jumbo jet that weighs I don't know how many hundreds of tons, and we sit in there, and we've got the effrontery to tell someone in Africa, I'll be there by 11:15 on Tuesday. And the amazing thing is that we usually are. Because we can guarantee that whatever the day, there isn't suddenly a day when law of aerodynamics isn't working today. Sorry, all flights are cancelled because somehow it's not working today. It's never like that, amen?
Yeah.
And you jump off a building anytime, anywhere, and you will always crash to the ground. The law of gravity never has a day off. No one's insulated from it. But what the secret is to get in the plane.
That's right.
Amen? Now, in the plane, when the plane takes off, exploiting the superior law of the law of aerodynamics, it just looks to you like the law of gravity has ceased to work anymore. But you open the door of that plane, and you'll soon find out that it's working okay. It's only within the plane it has no power over you. Get out of the plane, and it'll pull you just as relentlessly as ever it did. Amen? So that's why it says in Romans chapter 1, it's the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus who has set me free from the law of sin and death. So it's in Christ Jesus. If you get out of Jesus, you are as defeated by sin as ever you were. You'll never, ever make it on your own, not for 5 seconds. And if you've been a Christian for 50 years and have lived in victory over sin for 50 years, it's because you stayed in the plane. And you get out of the plane on your 51st year and you'll be as defeated by sin as ever you were. Amen? So the key is to stay in Christ Jesus. And in Christ Jesus, he bears you. You're in him. And now I think we understand what it means to be in him. It's an hereditary thing. But this is the mystery, it's also a choice thing. You can choose. And so that's why it says in Romans chapter 1, and Romans chapter 8, I'm sorry, and verse 1, it says this, and it's some translations they don't put it in, but it's absolutely there, and I want to tell you it's there. It says that we have to learn, first of all, to walk not after the flesh before we can walk in the Spirit. Amen? And that's what many of us have to learn. We're so used to running our own lives, we're so used to doing our own things, we're so used to making our own choices that we don't even realize we're doing it. And what we have to learn is to become passive in our own life in order that Jesus can literally live his life in us. And that's a learned, and it's a learned thing, but as you go on with, you know, intensely determined to do this, you get longer and longer periods where you learn to walk not after the flesh, and as a result you can walk after the Spirit. But it's in Christ Jesus. It's never ever in you. Your humanity is never ever able to exist alone. For one moment, it has to be in Christ Jesus. Amen? And then he'll give you the victory. Then you'll sit on the throne and all these other wonderful things will happen. Okay. So it's by grace that you've been saved through faith. It's not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. See this word, in Christ Jesus, in him. It's almost every other phrase is this. And now you can begin to see what is being said here. This is not just flowery language. This is a fundamental principle. Created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Therefore, okay, have you got that? Right, now let's move on to the next section now. Because that's how we walk in victory. That's how we rule from the throne. And we've got to know that as a reality. And that's why it tells us this. Let's just mention this. Galatians 3:27 says this. Don't you know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus have put on Christ? And the word there is that word enduo. And enduo is a tremendous word which is very hard to translate into English. It takes a whole phrase to explain it. Because the idea of enduo is that you sink down into something. And what you sink down into comes all over you, becomes intrinsically part of you. So what you sank down into, and you that sank down into it, you become indivisibly one, and you're no longer separable anymore. So that's what it means to put on Christ. Amen? It tells us, we shall see this later on, we're to put on the whole armor of God. We're to put on righteousness. We are to put on the new man. Every time it's this word endure. And you sink down into it in such a way that it becomes intrinsically part of you. It becomes like your skin. It's not that you can't take it off because it's you.
Yeah.
And you don't know anymore, really, where Christ begins and you ends and starts, and you don't really need to. You don't need to. And so, if you are genuinely baptized with faith, and I believe in teaching these things, if possible, for people when they're being baptized, and then I say, look, when we go through the act of baptism, I'm believing in something that's going to happen in the spirit realm that's going to hit you like a ton of bricks, and you're never going to be the same again. I don't believe baptism is simply an outward sign of an inward change of heart. I believe the change often takes place in the very act of baptism. I believe there's a mystery about baptism, which we've lost. We make it just a dead old routine when it should be a powerful, you know, crisis experience in which many people just leave behind the old man. They literally walk out the water and the old man's left drowned at the bottom forever. Hallelujah. I've seen people, habitual smokers, just walk out of the pool, totally released because they were rightly prepared for that act of baptism.
Hallelujah.
Seen people healed, physically healed. There's a lot of power in this which I think we've lost. It's a mystery which we've lost, and we've got to restore some of these mysteries. All right, let's move on now to verse 11 of chapter 2. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called the uncircumcision, by what is called the circumcision, made in the flesh of hands, that at that time you were without Christ. Now notice this, because this is very important to see this, because here's a tremendous key to genuine unity. Because while I might be a Jew, a proud religious Jew, after my Adamic nature, there's no such thing in the resurrection. In Christ there is neither... Okay, Jew nor Greek, or Jew nor Gentile. In Christ, see? Outside of Christ there is, but not in Christ. Amen? In Christ there's neither slave nor free, there's neither male nor female. Amen? In Christ. So, if you can imagine, here's a bus driving along, and there's maybe 15 Gentiles and 12 Jews in it, and they're very religious. You see, there was such a war between Jew and Gentile. Imagine the bus has a terrible accident and they all get killed. And they lay all the bodies out in the morgue. Let's throw in, you know, in America, it would be African Americans and whatever we call the Caucasians, I've forgotten, I forget all these politically correct terms. Whites, or anyway, and we got some Asians and we got some Native Americans, and they're all sitting in this bus together and we all get killed. In the morgue, you lay them all out in the morgue. Now, they're not a bit fussy about who they're laid next to when they're dead. They don't even know or care about these things anymore. Amen. Now, in Adam, it's a big issue, but in Christ, it's the other side of the grave. Amen. Can you see that? So the moment we've got into this, beginning to understand what it means to be in Christ, we have to tackle this issue of true unity. And true unity is much, much deeper than trying to do a few things together. And yet here's the, anyway, let's just read it on again. For at that time, this is talking to Gentiles who, of course, had not yet been transformed by being buried and raised with Christ. But at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. And I want to suggest something to you here, which God has recently convicted me of. And I think it's something that we're going to have to really work on, because there's coming a point when God is going to do a mighty, mighty work amongst Jewish people. They're going to be powerfully gathered into the church. Isn't it really a tragedy that when they come into the church, which ought to be rejoicing in its Jewish roots, every founder member of it, and Abraham himself and the Lord Jesus, and yet there's nothing left for them to identify with. Hear what I'm saying? It's become so Gentile through their period of blindness that when they come or try to come back in, there's nothing there that they can even be attracted to. Now, I'm not in saying this, and we're going to look at this perhaps more when I talk about the mystery of how the Jews are going to fit into the end time church. I just want to mention this right here. So the emphasis here is of the Gentiles having the privilege of coming in to be equally members of the commonwealth of Israel, equally grafted into the same root Abraham, equally having the same glorious heritage and access which the Jews should have had if only they'd believed on Jesus. But those roots are not annihilated. And when I saw it, it really hit me, and I thought, well, how easy would it be for a Jew to come into a church that I attend, or one that I've planted in the past? And I think, well, it would be very difficult for them. I think I've got to do something about this. Because what happens is we have to have separate messianic fellowships to give these people some sense of identity and belonging. And I think we've lost something here. Amen? No, obviously. It's not amen, but you'd think about that. Think about that. And I'm not saying let's get onto this crazy Jewish bandwagon and try and put on, you know, Jewish clothing and learn to speak Hebrew. I'm not saying any of that stuff. But I just see there that he's speaking to the Gentiles. Here's the apostle to the Gentiles saying, now listen, you Gentiles, when you were in Adam, you were all these things, but now you're in Christ. You've been brought in as equal, joyfully gathered members of the commonwealth of Israel, and now you are now the beneficiaries of the covenants and the promises. When you were outside, you had no hope and you were out without God in the world, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have now been brought near by the blood of Christ. Now we come down to verse 14. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is, the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace. Let's have a look at that for a little while. Let's go back to this word peace. We touched on it the other day. And I want to remind you that The word peace is, in its real deep meaning, is fulfilled when two people who were at enmity with each other, hated each other, were trying to kill each other, they laid down their arms and brought the war to an end. And that's not Bible peace, that's just the end of the war. For Bible peace to come, they have to fall into each other's arms and really love each other, really like each other, really enjoy each other, want to be with each other, and you can imagine coming into an intimate relationship with one another. Now that's what God wants with us. He wants us to be intimate with Him. He doesn't want us to be saved sinners not going to hell that He doesn't even know. And we saw how, we read this the other day, and I got to go over it a little bit just to remind you, that in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 19 and 20, we're told this, that God made peace through the blood of His cross. And what God did was, and please notice this, that God was the total innocent party. He had done nothing. But man was the totally guilty party. It was man who was the rebel. It was man who had gone away from God. It was man who then created his own false religion to make him feel a bit better. It was man that lived constantly in defiance and disobedience to God. Even when God had gathered together his own nation, Israel, it was still the most rebellious and disobedient people. And God, in the end, had to divorce them. Hello. But then, in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ, He came and dealt with that Adamic nature which was causing the separation. It was when sin entered into Adam, or when Satan got his fingers on Adam, that Adam became incompatible with God and hated the very God who loved him and created him. And became enemies of the very one who loved him and wanted fellowship with him. Now, here's the thing that absolutely blows me away, is that it was God entirely who took the initiative to make peace.
Right.
While we were enemies, it says, God revealed His love towards us, that while we were enemies, amen, He died on a cross to reconcile us. He didn't wait for any response from us. He didn't wait for us to want to heal the breach. He came Himself to bring that mighty healing of the breach. And it was as if it was that costly love that finally wakes men up to love Him back. And that's exactly how it works. Now, I want us to see this because this is a pattern. And that's why Matthew chapter 5 and verse 9, it says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the mature grown-up sons of God." There's something mature about peacemakers.
Yep.
You can be a child of God, but you can be a troublemaker. But if you are a mature, grown-up son of God, you have to be a peacemaker. You have no choice. And I want us to learn this lesson here, because what I see is when you are risen again in Christ, the peacemaker is now who you are in Him. Amen? And you so want reconciliation, you so want peace, that you're prepared to take the initiative to mend the breach, even from your perspective, and even if it was absolutely true, the cause of the breach was entirely the other party's responsibility. That's what's so amazing about this. As I told you, when my wife got gloriously delivered from the old man, she stopped hating her mother, but furthermore, she went out of her way to mend the relationship. Her mother never did a thing. Although actually, her mother was largely to blame for the condition of the broken and damaged personality of my wife. It was her that had caused all the damage, but she never lifted a finger to heal it until my wife was regenerated, the Spirit of Christ came into her, then she went out of her way to mend the relationship. She became a peacemaker. And after she had loved her mother to death, her mother finally died to that ghastly, cruel, wicked woman that she was, that almost destroyed my wife, and became born again, and then of course they came perfectly reconciled. But the initiative, and I find this again and again, in reality, the initiative is often from the person who is the offended party. But once you are raised with Christ, you can't have the bits of Christ that you like and leave the bits you don't like. I want His power, but I don't want all this forgiveness stuff. Well, beloved, that's impossible. You either are in him or you're not in him. It's either totally what he is or it's not at all what he is. There's no picking and choosing the bits that you like or think that you need most. Hello? And so sitting upon a throne follows just a few lines before going out in this costly way to make reconciliation. And what Jesus did was he took to the cross and put to death that which was in those arrogant, unsaved religious Jews that would have them actually go around killing people because they wouldn't conform to their doctrine, which of course the exhibit A would be the Apostle Paul himself. He said, I'm the chief of sinners because I persecuted the church. By the time he got saved, he was a multi-murderer. Come on. And he was out to murder anyone who was deviant from this precious Jewish religion, which he held to be so marvelous and wonderful that anyone, we're gonna kill him. Now, he gets the revelation that that proud, murdering, arrogant Pharisee goes down into the grave, never comes up again. But a new man who loves the lost, loves his own nation, even though they've tried several times to kill him. All you get back from him, if you read Romans chapter 10, Romans 11, he said, oh, my cry is that, he said, I would be prepared to be accursed from Christ in order to get my own people saved. Amen? He's a peacemaker. He can go out to the Gentiles and go to these terrible, blaspheming, dark, demonic, wicked Thessalonians worshipping idols and dancing before demons and probably cutting themselves and painting themselves with all kind of stuff, and he goes into that hell hole and clutches them out of the darkness and turns them into the most marvelous jewels that probably the church has ever seen. Now that's the ministry of reconciliation. And I want us to comprehend this, because if that's not in us, we're not going to produce a city-taking church. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one, has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is, the law of commandments. Now, you see, this is what makes division, is this, that if anybody's going to get on with you, usually, they've got to adjust to your standards. I mean, I lived in India for 14 years, and I didn't live in some white missionary bungalow. I lived right in the smack in the middle of some of the darkest and demonic parts of Bombay. I lived right amongst. I didn't see a white face for months sometimes, and I got to the point where I didn't even notice, I didn't care, and I became thoroughly, culturally transformed. And things that I found so offensive didn't bother me anymore. I mean, I could give you some little demonstrations. I mean, because this is Indian culture. I mean, the way that Indians use the toilet and the bathroom is very different to the way we use it. And you can say, oh, that's terrible. But you see, you're saying terrible from your perspective. You say, well, if you will become like what I consider to be a civilized white man, I'll have some fellowship with you, you see. And you've set out rules and regulations. See, the Jews said, all right, you become a proselyte, you become a Jew and learn all the Jewish ways, be circumcised and keep the law of Moses, then we'll receive you. But even then, as a kind of second-class citizen. But then we can eat with you. Then we can have fellowship with you. But while you keep don't keep all these rules and regulations, you're not obeying my standards of what I think is pleasing to God, then I can't have anything to do with you. And you know, a lot of our attempts at reconciliation, we're not prepared to yield up one particle of our culture. Amen? And you know, I hope this makes sense to you, but I tell you, in Christ Jesus, it went to death. That's what he's saying. That middle wall of partition of rules and regulations, some of them were biblical, some of them were doctrinal. And I can't fellowship with you, brother, because you've got a different view of the end time events. That's what Christians will say. Or we can't, you know, they say, oh yeah, he's a so-and-so. They'll just hear you teach once and they'll label you as a certain kind of Christian. He's one of those prosperity guys. We want nothing whatever to do with him. Because you've set boundaries around requirements of conduct, certain doctrinal beliefs which are a prerequisite for making fellowship. If we have a prayer meeting, then you've got to do it our way. If you do it in a way that we can consider offensive, then we're not going to meet with you anymore. Amen? But, you know, this is the strange thing, is you can go to all kinds of churches around the world, and with all kinds of, within the parameters of certain basic truths, all kinds of different doctrines, and you find Jesus in the midst of them, perfectly happy. He don't care. I mean, you go to Venezuela, as I've been privileged to do, and I tell you, the women will grab you and take you into a swirling dance to Jesus. There's nothing improper about it, but if you are a respectable Englishman, it's quite a change. To be gathered up by this enthusiastic Hispanic lady, and she'll kiss you, and she'll, and you just realize, then you think, hey, when you've got over the shock, you realize this is fantastic, but I tell you, is Jesus there? Absolutely. Absolutely. And then you go into real Africa, and I tell you, those precious people, they are absolutely amazing. And they know things about God and the ways of God that we know absolutely nothing about. And I tell you, I've got at their feet, and I said, look, teach me. I'm this stupid intellectual white man, and I can't get it. Something's happened to my mind. You know, and you meet some of these guys in Nigeria, some of these guys in Uganda, and I tell you, they are in touch with God, and they're in a way with God that is totally beyond our experience. You know, what happened to Britain? What happened to London? We were crying out to God to do something in London. And what he did was he sent a contingent of Ghanaians and Nigerians to London. I was in this church, it's called Kensington Temple. I'd taught in this church, I know the pastor quite well. It was a good old Pentecostal church, 300 or 400 people. Ever since the days of the Jeffrey brothers, it had been about 300 or 400 people. And then suddenly, this, I think it was about 200 or 300 Nigerians came to London from the revival that's going on there. And they came in and they thought, man, there's demons everywhere. They can see them. They really can. They said, yeah, here, why don't you clear them out? I said, well, what do you mean? Well, look, you've got to do this and this. And these guys come in and they take over the prayer meeting, and it becomes a Nigerian prayer meeting. And within a year, the power of God hits that church. That church is now, in that building, there's more than 8,000 people. And they've planted out, the last time I was with them, they'd planted out 84 new churches across the city of London. And they're planting out one new church every week in London. That's the only church I know with a church planting department that plans to plant out one new church every week. They're studying the demographics, they're studying the ethnicity, and they're sending out, because they know, although they're free in the Lord, because I think there's 143 different nationalities in that church now. Almost the whole world is there. But it was the Nigerians who taught us how to pray. The Brits hadn't got a clue. Hadn't got a clue. Oh Lord, yea, verily thou art. Come on, shut up, let's get on with it. It's absolutely true. And they said, this is what they said to me, they said, God spoke to us to come to England to pay our debt. Because about 150 years ago, young people from the evangelical awakening Europe went to these shores and they died. Their average expectation of life was between 2 and 3 years. Died of every kind of disease and sickness. And while the white colonial thing was horrible, I tell you, that missionary The salt was wonderful. It was marvelous. And they said they brought us the gospel. And now in our nation, we're reaping a mighty harvest because of what they sowed 100 years ago. So we've come back to England to pay our debt because, he said, you're desperately needy. You've lost the essentials. And so these precious brothers, and they're starting to come to America. You've got two kinds. You've got three kinds of people coming to America from Africa. There's the absolute down and out crooks. Watch out for them. There are those that have come because they need money for the genuine work that they're doing in America, and that's okay. But there's a third category of come who have not come for anything other than to give themselves to serve this nation, to teach it principles in the spirit that we've long since lost, if ever we knew these things. And these are amazing men and amazing women who are coming to us, and with all the middle wall, the barriers of partition, they've gone down and they've just come to serve us in the most amazing way. And I thank God for these fantastic days. And I want you to hate the little boxes of our impenetrable ethnicity as much as God does. See, if the Apostle Paul had not had this revelation, we would have had Jewish and Gentile churches from day one. And I don't think we would have taken any cities. Because a house divided against itself cannot stand. Amen? And God is not going to save a city through the white church or through the African-American church, or he's going to save it through the one church of Jesus. And it's one thing to have nice little polite, you know, reconciliation meetings where you wash your dear brother's foot and then after that you don't see each other for another year until there's another event. That's not what we're talking about.
Right.
We're talking about making one. Amen. Do you hear my heart? And I tell you, this is, I believe, when this thing cracks, that's going to be the major breakthrough that's going to give us the city. Until it cracks, we're not going to take anything. You can go to Argentina as often as you like. You can go to any of the hot spots, and you can try and imbibe what's there, but you can't bring it back to a divided church and have it work effectively. Now, having said that, you can fall off the log the other side and say, well, we can't do anything until there's total unity. Now, that's not true either. All I'm saying is that in the hearts of those that God's going to use, there's a heart as wide as the city that will receive, love, and embrace anybody. But you can't wait for everybody to get on board because you'll wait forever. Now, that's the balance between these two extremes. If your heart is wide open and you are a peacemaker, doing what you can to bring reconciliation, then you're going to see this thing developing. Amen? He abolished in his flesh the enmity. In other words, in the flesh of Jesus, which became the Adamic nature, which went down to hell and never came back, he put all this stuff. And then he created in himself one new man from the two, just making peace. So if any ethnicity is raised in Christ, what they were ethnically, which caused division, they no longer can continue to be in the resurrection. Amen? Because there's only one new man in Christ. You see, in Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There's no ethnicity. There's no gender. There's no social status, which was a big problem in Britain. You had to be born of the right family to get to the top. And all that stuff is dead in Christ. Amen? And this has got to happen. And probably this is where some of you have got to go and say, right, we're going to do our homework on this. And we've heard God through Alan. And we're not going to tolerate this. I'm desperate, I'm broken, I'm weeping, I'm crying to God to break down the middle walls of partition in San Antonio, Texas. I can't say that we've seen something magnificent happen yet, but it's happening. I mean, we've been accepted as individuals. largely, we can go into those Hispanic churches and they realize that we're okay, and you know, wish to God I could speak Spanish, but I can't. But we're accepted because they can sense our heart and our spirit. So we meet with them over there, we meet with these over there, but we can't get this happening yet, but it's coming. And when it comes, that's when we're going to see the breakthrough. Amen. But notice once again, because this is what I believe is so important, that in real peacemaking, it's the person who's been the wounded and offended party that's often moved by Christ to take the initiative to mend the bridge. And I believe our precious African-American brothers have got to hear me when I say this, because, you know, if you go and forgive white folk for all they've done to black folk, and wait for them to say sorry, and not wait for them to say sorry, I tell you, that's going to be so supernatural and so amazing, it's going to break millions of these hard hearts. It's going to melt them. They say, we want our rights, we want you to, and I can understand the anger. I mean, I've never lived in a racial society before. And it's been a learning experience for me. It really has, but I've read the history. And I tell you, when I've read of some of the incidents that have taken place in this nation, I'm absolutely ashamed to have the same color skin as those. I think, how could anybody behave like that? And I can understand the offense. And all the broken treaties that were just abused by land-grabbing, greedy, money-making men. Brothers, you know, if you're Caucasian like me, we've got a lot to ask God's forgiveness for. We can't stand on some proud pinnacle and say, you know, we're disgusting in Adam, but in Christ we're a new creation. And we've got to be received as that. Amen? But I see here, and I see in so much peacemaking, I see that, you know, when Christ gets hold of a man and he really is raised with Christ, and that old Adamic nature with all its resentments, all its offenses is buried and dead, then that man who's got the most right, if you like God himself, to say, all right, well, I'll do something when they say they're sorry. But if you humble yourself and go and make the first move, it's so endorsed by God, it's so crushingly powerful. That no one, apart from the devil himself, could resist it. Amen? And I'm looking to see that. And I know that God's beginning to speak to people about that, because when this great unity comes, we're going to see something powerful come out of it. And verse 12, and he came and preached peace to you who were far off and to those who were near. He put to death the enmity in the cross. He reconciled them both to God in one body. These are all these tremendous phrases. Verse 18, for through him we both have access by the one Spirit to the Father. Therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners and fellow citizens, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Now, can you see, in a way, that it's when the apostles and the prophets are foundationally laying this that it allows the whole church to get on board?
Yes.
Can you see this phrase of it's on the foundation of apostles. What do you mean? Well, we've got house groups, we've got elders. No, listen, it's talking about reconciliation. That's the first layer that's laid on this house that's going to take the cities for God. The first layer of stones has got to be stones that make us one, not that have efficient house groups. Useful as they may be, a divided church with house groups is not going to take a city. And so I believe I think you can almost feel, I hope you can, the almost pain in my heart over these things, because I'm apostolic. I see these things. And if you're prophetic, you're going to see these things, and you're going to see this as a first priority. Say, look, hey, we've got to get to work here. We can't just be a nice, you know, Caucasian or African-American church that attends the annual reconciliation meeting and then goes back to do our own thing for the rest of the year. We can't live like that anymore. And I believe apostolic and prophetic ministry, if it's truly foundational, has got to lead the way in these things.
Yes.
That's one of the many reasons why I absolutely love Bishop Joseph Garlington. And his ministry is called Reconciliation Ministries. And he has a heart for this. And what's more, he's practiced it for decades, long before most people could see this. There's a very powerful message that I've heard him preach, which is this: do you want to be right or reconcile? It's a powerful message. And he's a very precious man. And we've got some wonderful brothers from every side of this divide in this meeting. And I'm not feeling so much I'm preaching to you, but I'm sort of saying, look, through us, brothers, if we're apostolic and if we're prophetic, this has got to get out to the church at large. It's got to become a priority that maybe is not had before. Okay. And once again, let me stress that we all end up, I believe, with a new deep appreciation for our Jewish heritage. And I want to be very sensitive and helpful for the Jewish people to come into the I'm going to call it, as the Bible does, the Israel of God, the multiracial one nation that we've all become, the one body that we are, the one household which we all are. And then it talks about the whole building is fitted together, growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Because when we build that sort of church, the Spirit of God can come and live powerfully within it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, we finished a page today. Well, we got on to page 22. Well, we're through page 22. Well, we're going to close this session now.